have decided gently to ask you to chair this this committee. I'm glad to chair this this committee. And good morning, everybody in the room. Mm-hmm. And just before giving you the lead for your presentation, I would like to briefly present the committee. And the committee, we have not only an international committee, but it's also an intercontinental committee, right? And so, starting from the far, we'll have Professor Itai Eina from the University of Sydney in Australia. As far as I know, you are not in Sydney today. I don't know if it's right.
Yeah, sorry to disappoint.
No, it doesn't matter.
Sorry to disappoint.
Yeah. Then getting closer, we'll have Professor Panos Papanastasiou from the University of Cyprus, I believe in Nicosia. And getting again closer, we have Stephanie Chaya, which is also senior researcher at ENSTA in the Paris area. And then we getting again closer, we have the two local people, you know. To my right, Professor Nicolas Moes, here from École Centrale de Nantes, as the same as the supervisor of the thesis, Professor Ioannis Stéphanou. I mean, Samuel Forrest, who has been one of the reviewers, who is also senior researcher at CNRS at École des Mines in Paris, cannot join the meeting, but he has sent a letter with some questions for you later on, okay? Mm-hmm. And I will try to ask them to you, okay? And everything is done. I hope everything will continue to work. We'll just cross our fingers and see. And now you have about 45 minutes to try to summarize for us, you know, the main findings and main results that you have obtained. Alexandros, Stathas, it's for you. Now.
Thank you. So, I'll be defending in front of you my thesis with title Numerical Modeling of Earthquake Faults. And I must confess that my thesis today contains a mystery. But before I introduce you to the mystery, let me walk you at first through an introduction on earthquakes. What is an earthquake? According to the theory of the elastic rebound, an earthquake is the sudden movement of earth blocks at great depths, releasing the stored elastic energy. The elastic energy is released 5% of it to the surface in the form of seismic waves, while the rest 95% is accumulated inside the small region of the fault that is called the fault coach. The fault coach accumulates the majority of the seismic steel, and it's where the frictional weakening mechanisms take place. In order to understand how an earthquake is nucleating, the model, the simply yet effective model of the spring slider is a nice answer to it. In this case, the earth block is modeled by a rigid block, and its elastic deformation is taken into account by an elastic spring that is connected to the block and is forced by a continuous rate of velocity at its free end. If we now perform the three-body diagram of the spring slider, we see two forces taken into effect: the elastic force from the spring and the frictional force from the friction with the quartz plane that the block lies on. Now, initially, the elastic force is small and the block does not move while it is in equilibrium. At some point, the friction reaches its maximum value, and if we consider that the friction remains constant during the sleep, the equilibrium point remains to be only one, and a soft aseismic slip occurs. However, if we take into account frictional weakening in our calculations, then we can see that two equilibria are found, and the first one becomes the initial one becomes unstable, and the block will move towards the second equilibrium, causing cosismic slip. In this case, the elastic energy of the block will be transformed into the released energy that radiates to the surface and the dissipated energy that's taken into that dissipates inside the follicles. Thus, we have seen that the frictional weakening controls both the earthquake nucleation, the radiated energy to the surface, as well as dissipation. Now, there are different frictional weakening mechanisms that one can take into account. Mechanical weakening, flash heating and malformation of the asperity contacts, thermal decomposition of minerals due to frictional heating, the list goes on. And finally, we have thermal pressurization of pore fluid at the fault boats, which is actually the main weakening mechanism that we take into account in this presentation. Apart from the frictional weakening mechanisms, friction is also affected by the width of the localized zone inside the fault boats. This means that as we decrease the size of the localized zone, friction drops steeper and dissipation is reduced. Now, the solution for the frictional weakening due to the thermal pressurization is given by Rice in 2006. And it's the following relation. Now, here we can see a frictional, mu is the frictional coefficient, sigma zero is an effective normal stress, and delta is the seismic slip, and lambda star is an effective length, that is, it's an effective diffusion length that takes into account the specific heat density of the material, the thermal pressurization coefficient of the material, the hydraulic and thermal diffusivities, as well as the shearing velocity. Now, the solution has this form during the sleep, and if we compare with the numerical solution that we took from our advanced numerical models using Cosgrain thermohydromechanical couplings, we see that there is a difference. And we are very interested to understand why do the two solutions differ in such a way. So, having explained to you what the mystery is, my presentation will have three parts. First, I will examine the regularization approaches for simplified continua. Then, I will be applying the regularization approach that I chose for the shearing of the mature fault boats, and finally I will provide you an answer to the mystery. So, for the regularization approaches that one can use, there are various regularization approaches that one can use, and in the case of simplified continua, it's worth looking at strain localization as a bifurcation problem, and applying the regularization approaches to see what is their effect on the strain localization. So, during shearing of the fault boats, one would assume that initially homogeneous deformation would take place. However, this configuration is shown to be unstable, as we will discuss in later slides. And this means that a localized form of the slip will occur. And in this case, we are interested in what is the localization width. To understand what is the localization width, it is useful to see strain localization as a bifurcation problem. And here is a very simple example based on the posterior elastoplasticity with strain softening. In this case, in the homogeneous deformation, the steady state has the following equilibrium equations, and we can apply different perturbations into the medium with the following form, where the form is a product of an exponential term with a periodic term. The exponential term is characterized by a constant by a constant exponent, which is the Lyapunov coefficient, and the periodic term is characterized by the wavelength parameter or the wave number, respectively. We can apply different perturbations into the medium that respect the boundary conditions. the solution finally comes from the superposition of the perturbations and the homogeneous solution. And the perturbed equilibrium equation, in this case, reads as follows. If we now introduce the material behavior into the equilibrium equation, we obtain the characteristic matrix of the problem, which determinant needs to be zero, and thus the dispersion relation between the Lyapunov coefficient and the wavelength can be found. In this particular case, the Lyapunov coefficient is given by the relation in the picture, and we notice that the Lyapunov coefficient tends to infinity as the wavelength increases, as the wavelength tends to zero. Thus, we notice that the real part of the Lyapunov coefficient is greater than zero, and the homogeneous deformation is unstable. Moreover, localization will take place on a mathematical plane. This is also shown in our numerical results, where we see that as we increase the number of elements in our problem, we obtain a smaller localization width of the width of one element, and the dissipated energy decreases continuously. Now, this goes against the experimental observations, both in metals and so on. And a kind of regularization approach needs to be implemented in order to avoid strain localization on a mathematical plane. Such an approach is the Posey-Elastovich viscoplasticity with strain rate hardening, the Posey-Elastovich viscoplasticity with strain rate hardening and inertia, the Posey-Elastovich viscoplasticity with thermohydromechanical couplings, and the Posey-Elastoplasticity. Other approaches are also available, however, we did not take them into account in this presentation. Now, considering the Posey-Elastovich viscoplasticity, the perturbation analysis of this problem reads as follows. First, we apply a perturbation into the homogeneous state, and the perturbed equilibrium equations are given in the picture. Now, if we introduce the material behavior into the equilibrium equation, we obtain the characteristic matrix, which leads to a Lyapunov coefficient that, in this case, is constant and independent of the wavelength. In this case, we see again that the real part of the Lyapunov coefficient is bigger than zero, thus the homogeneous deformation is unstable, and localization in this case is based on a selected imperfection length. Numerically, this means that as we decrease the imperfection in our models, the localization width decreases, and actually the localization width is equal to the imperfection width. This means that the frictional weakening, in this case, is not a material characteristic, rather a parameter that the analyst introduces into the analysis for the 1D cases. Now, what would happen if we introduce inertia into the discussion? In this case, the perturbed equilibrium equation will read as follows, and the normalized, in its normalized expanded form, is the following. In this form, the V parameter is the normalized velocity parameter, T is the viscous non-dimensional parameter, and H is the normalized softening parameter. We are interested to understand what is the localization width in this case, and if mesh dependence is occurring in our results. I am obliged to say here that we obtain different results than the previous literature of the subject. Now, the previous partial differential equation admits solutions of the following form, where the exponential is has an imaginary exponent. Now, k is the complex wave number, and omega is the complex frequency. And it's in its expanded form, the solution has an exponential term that is due to the amplitude, and a periodic term. Now, this form can be brought into the more familiar Lyapunov, the more familiar form that takes into account the Lyapunov coefficient, taking into consideration the relationship between the Lyapunov coefficient and the complex frequency. In this case, the solution can be written with the Lyapunov exponent, and this constitutes a potentially unbound term, while the rest of the solution is corresponds to a specific traveling velocity that we impose on the perturbation. The solution, again, is a superposition of traveling waves, and previous research neglect the positive Lyapunov exponent inside the exponential. Thus, they are unable to predict an increase in the localization or an increase in the exponent of the localization. If we now apply the previous relationships into the equilibrium equation, we obtain a dispersion relation function, and we can see that a pole is present in our numerical results. This has been shown also in a paper we published in the Journal of Computer Methods in Applied Mechanics and Engineering. And in this case, localization on a mathematical plane will happen because the real part of the wavelength tends to infinity, while the imaginary part of the frequency, the real part of the Lyapunov coefficient, is greater than zero. We perform a numerical solution to the above partial differential equation, and we apply three different perturbations of the smaller of decreasing width. The smallest width is in the middle of the model, and we see that as we increase the time in our analysis, the smallest perturbation increases the fastest. We continue with a fully nonlinear analysis of the problem. And we see that if we take the parameters that are shown into the literature, no localization on a mathematical plane will take place. However, if we take our set of material parameters, localization on a mathematical plane will take place, since for increasing number of elements, the localization width decreases, and the plastic strain fails to converge in a constant value. Now, if we take the parameters of that we see in the literature and simply increase the geometric length of our application, we see again that localization on a mathematical plane ensues. This, thus, a criterion for noticeable strain localization takes place, and we see that for localization to become noticeable, the characteristic time of the problem needs to be bigger than the inverse of the pole frequency. We continue with the thermohydromechanical couplings as a means to regularize strain localization on a mathematical plane. And in this case, the equilibrium equation reads in the following way. The yield condition is given as follows, where tau zero is a yield condition for a geomaterial, where tau zero is the cohesion term, hc and gamma p are the softening and the accumulated plastic strain, while the phi is the friction angle, and P prime is the effective pressure applied into the geomaterial. Now, the heat equation that we couple our equilibrium equations with is the following, where we can see that the parachute diffusion terms and a term due to the dissipation and yielding that acts as a thermal load. Now, the pressure equation that is coupled to the specific problem has the same form, and we can see the pressure diffusion terms, a term that is due to thermal pressurization, and a term that is due to the volumetric expansion. We notice that the parameter beta star here is the mixture compressibility, a parameter that is important in the diffusivity of the material, in the hydraulic diffusivity of the material. Thermal pressurization will increase the pore fluid pressure inside the material, and therefore the effective stress, the effective pressure will drop, thus decreasing frictional stress. This is a result that is also known in, from the literature, and a way of seeing how visualizing how thermal pressurization works is the following. First, yielding occurs, then heat is produced due to the dissipation, which leads to a temperature increase, and due to thermal pressurization, a pore fluid pressure increase ensues that drops the frictional strength and further intensifying yielding. Now, doing the bifurcation analysis in this specific problem, we see that the perturbed equilibrium and mass balance equations are given as following. The material description is given by the yield criterion that I presented before in the 1D case, and we see that the plastic potential for this case has a dilatancy angle that is equal to zero for our analysis. Therefore, the stress rates are given as following. Inserting the stress rates inside the perturbed equilibrium equations, we see that the Lyapunov coefficient has the following form. And again, we see that the Lyapunov coefficient tends to infinity as the wavelength tends to zero. Thus, the homogeneous deformation is unstable, and localization in the mathematical plane will take place. This is also shown in our numerical results, where we see that as we increase the number of elements, localization width decreases, and mesh dependence of the numerical results ensues. We'll apply now the final form of regularization for our problem, which is the introduction of a Coserac continuum. In this case, the perturbed equilibrium equation is written as follows. The material behavior is given by the following laws, and applying the material behavior into the equilibrium equations gives us the characteristic matrix, which must have a determinant that is equal to zero, and therefore the dispersion relation has the following form in the diagram. We see that the Lyapunov coefficient in this case has still a positive part, thus homogeneous deformation is unstable, and the localization width, however, where we see the maximum Lyapunov coefficient, the lambda critical, is different than zero. Thus, we can see that in our numerical results, where we see that as we increase the number of elements, the localization width tends to be equal to the critical wavelength over 2, and thus mesh independent results can ensue. Now, from this approach, summarizing, we can say that from all the approaches worked here, only the Coserac approach seems to regularize the strain localization in the mathematical plane. In the ensuing conditions, we'll continue with applying the complete Coserac model with thermo-hydromechanical couplings for the shearing of a mature fault group. We'll study the effect of the shear velocity on the fault friction, the physical mechanism for the observed response, as well as a comparison to the rate and state phenomenology and to experimental results. Finally, a comparison with the theory will be performed. The problem we are trying to solve is the shearing of a mature fault coach, which is simulated as a 1D problem. I'm going to present to you stress and displacement diagrams on top of the layer, as well as state variable profiles along the height of the layer. The material we use is a deuterpragger linear elastic perfectly plastic material with a non-associative yield condition where the deladency is equal to zero. The pressure and the parachute couplings will be taken into account, and the discretization will be with 8 mixed finite elements of reduced integration. We'll apply large displacement with an arbitrary Lagrangian Eulerian procedure, and we'll study the influence of the shearing rate and the influence of the viscosity in our problem. Now, this problem was studied with the use of the numerical geolab, which is an in-house code provided by Professor Stefano, that is based on the Phoenix project, and that takes the variational form of the equilibrium equations as input, and analyzes the problem. My tasks in this code were to formulate the multiphysical problem, introduce the von Neumann terms in the analysis, verify the residual terms, introduce the Jacobian terms, do unit tests for all the different cases, apply the arbitrary Lagrangian procedure, and finally do the documentation of the code. Now, the appropriate boundary conditions for our problem are the following. We see that the permeability of the fault boats is smaller than the permeability of its surroundings, and this is a known result from IBM 2000. Similar result comes for the conductivity of the fault boats, which is due to the Pasellet and Yao in 2014 and 2015, and thus we can see that as a first approximation, isothermal drain boundary conditions seem to be more realistic for the problem at hand. Now, the scaled equations of the problem are given as follows, where we see that the proposed scaling allows for the investigation of the specimen's height and shearing rate in the fault friction. Now, the inertial number as well as the momentum of inertia number. For this problem, for the scaling, they are very small, and thus a quasi-static description can be applied. where we see that the normalized diffusivity parameters for thermal and hydraulic diffusivities, where for the thermal diffusivity we have a KT term that is the thermal conductivity, and for the hydraulic diffusivity we have a key term that is the permeability, and the term due to the water viscosity. The final form of the equation read as follows, and this is also known by previous analysis on the subject for by Rades in 2018. I remind you again how thermal pressurization works, and the first form of our analysis, we reproduce the results obtained by Rades et al. In 2018 and expected theoretically by Sulem et al. In 2011. We see that as the friction increases, temperature increases due to the dissipation, and due to thermal pressurization, for fluid pressure increases. This leads to a decrease in the fault friction. This is all good, but what would happen if we increase the values of the cosismic slip that we apply into our model? In this case, we see that as we increase the shearing rate during our analysis, we see that for faster shear rate, a faster stress drop occurs, and also a lower minimum friction is achieved at the initial stages of the analysis. However, at the last stages, friction regain takes place, and frictional oscillations occur. By applying now cosmic slip values and shearing slip velocities that are common in fault, in earthquakes, common in the situation of an earthquake, we see that we have initially the frictional weakening due to thermal pressurization, then we have a frictional regain due to the diffusion at the boundaries, and the frictional oscillations happen around a residual frictional value. The frictional oscillations are also accompanied by a traveling strain localization along the height of the layer. We present also the values of temperature and pore fluid pressure at the end of the analysis. This behavior is shown to be similar to a Portevone-Chatelier phenomenon in metals, as well as eddies in a 2D granular media. Now, the mechanism that explains how the thermal, the traveling occurs is the following. Assuming that initially we have a yielding region, then due to dissipation, thermal pressure, thermal temperature will increase, and this will lead to an increase in pressure. Now, we'll consider two points, X1 and X2. The point X1 is in the middle of the layer, and the point X2 slightly to the right. And we see that at the initial stages, thermal pressurization will continue, and both points tend to increase, tend to have an increasing pore fluid pressure. However, as pore fluid pressure builds up, due to a reduction in the frictional strength, the middle point will start to have a slightly decreasing rate, even reversing the pore fluid pressure in this point. Therefore, it's in a position of hardening. The point on the right, however, will continue to have an increase in the pore fluid pressure all the time, and thus softening will occur. Thus, yielding will be accumulated towards the softening region. This is also something that we see in our numerical analysis, where we see that the maximum of the pore fluid pressure is behind the maximum of the yielding of the plastic strain rate profile. We continue by the introduction of viscosity into our problem and comparisons to the rate and state phenomenology. For a material obeying the rate and state material law, we see that when velocity stepping occurs, a strain rate hardening response is expected, while this is followed by frictional softening due to the introduction of internal state variables controlling the memory of the material. Now, we apply a series of velocity stepping analysis where we model the behavior, the strain hardening behavior of our model by introducing thermohydromechanical model with a perzinal viscoplasticity. We'll introduce different characteristic lengths and check their influence on the frictional response. First things first, we saw that indeed we have an abrupt frictional increase due to the velocity stepping, and this is a characteristic of the Reagan state phenomenology. Now, considering the introduction of the Cosera radius into our model, this is a characteristic length that it comes from the microstructure. It endows our model with a finite localization of width, and thus ends with a distributed thermal load. We see, however, that if we change the Cosera parameter, even by 4 orders of magnitude, the frictional response does not change. This is not the case if we change the mixture compressibility of our material, where we see that the mixture compressibility is connected with the diffusion length, and thus diffusivity is what governs the behavior. This is also shown in experiments in comparison with experiment. The experiment is shown on the left of the picture, and there are numerical results on the right, where we see that considering the normalized value of the hydraulic diffusivity, the blue curves and the red curves, they have the same more or less diffusivities, and thus we did get a behavior that is qualitatively similar. We'll compare it now with existing theoretical results, and we'll see that initially we use the solution taken from Lackenbrough, which is under adiabatic undrained conditions and tends to zero, and this is a relationship that our Cosera model with localized shear under adiabatic undrained condition also follows. Indeed, also in this case the frictional strength tends to zero as shear accumulates. We continue now with the introduction of the isothermal drain case, and first we have the model of Rice I presented to you at the beginning, where we see that for the Cosera model, we compare it with the Cosera model for finite thickness and under isothermal drain boundary conditions. Now, we see that the numerical solution diverges. Thus, thermal pressurization at the initial state, thus, the key points from our analysis, from part two of our analysis, is that thermal pressurization is indeed present in the initial stages of the problem. Frictional gain is achieved due to the diffusion in large precision sleeves. This is also accompanied with frictional oscillations and traveling strain localization. This is in agreement with the Reagan state phenomenology and experimental results. However, we disagree with the thermal pressurization model, with the main thermal pressurization model. And in the next part of my presentation, I'll explain to you why this difference occurs. So, in part three of my presentation, I will provide to you an answer to the mystery. So, the basic assumption of the established theory are as follows. According to the model of slip on a mathematical plane under thermal pressurization weakening mechanism, we see that yielding is localized on a mathematical plane, yielding is stationary inside the fault codes, the boundaries of the fault codes are considered to lie at infinity, and the boundary conditions are considered to be isothermal drain. The following model is then proposed, where the yielding zone is stationary. This is shown by the introduction of the Dirac delta plane there. And we see that all the frictional heating and the thermal pressurization will happen on a specific point in the medium. Now, the solution to the above to this problem will be given by direct application of the Green's theorem, where an integral equation will take place. The G star parameter here is the Green's function kernel, and its explanation is as follows. The Green's function kernel describes an increasing pressure at a position T at time T for a thermal load theta at a position T prime and at time T prime. Now, considering that the position of the pore fluid pressure maximum and the unit thermal load is the same, the unbounded for the unbounded stationary case and the bounded periodic case, the Green function kernels are given as follows. The second kernel, for the bounded domain where the localization travels, was not existing in the literature, and thus I was the one that derived it. The solution methodology that we will use is the convolution quadrature method with the Z transform, and also a collocation method. Now, for this case, we see that for faster shear, we have a faster strength, faster drop, and the friction drops monotonously to zero. If we now continue with a stationary yielding plane on a bounded domain, we see that complete frictional regain is taken into our results after the initial frictional decrease. This is because the calculation of temperature reaches a steady state. We see that the difference between the unbounded domain and the bounded domain is present even for small slips, and the difference is not negligible. Finally, for a traveling yielding plane on a bounded domain, we see a behavior that is characterized by oscillations, frictional regain, and frictional plateau that is smaller than the initial yielding, because in this case the thermal load is continuously traveling inside the medium. Comparing our COSERA model with the simplified model, we see that the two models exhibit qualitatively the same behavior, and thus new boundaries for the fault friction during co-seismic slip have been proposed. These are important for applications in slip transition from a seismic to co-seismic and control applications. In conclusions, we studied different regularization mechanisms for avoiding strain localization in mathematical plane. We provided a numerical and theoretical proof of why this cause is not regularizing strain localization in mathematical plane. And in part two, we shared a mature fault during large seismic slip with large seismic slip rates. And this, we also provided a schematic explanation for the traveling strain localization and the frictional oscillations. Addition of the persisting average scope plasticity reproduces the rate and state methodology without the need for the internal memory wiring, and this is in agreement with experiments. Finally, we provided an explanation for the discrepancy with the main model of thermal pressurization. We expanded the main model of thermal pressurization for bounded fault gauges and traveling strain localization, and we saw that our model is actually in qualitative agreement with the expanded model for thermal pressurization. New boundaries, I must stress that new boundaries for the fault friction have been proposed, which is important again for slip transition and earthquake control. Continuing on to the perspectives of my study, further study for the boundary conditions in thermal pressurization experiments is needed based on our analysis. A further study for traveling strain localization and its interaction with the fault walls is needed. Our numerical results indicate higher frequencies to the frictional content of every first place, which our current models lack, and thus further study of the relationship between the fault wall thickness and the friction, the frequency of the frictional oscillation needs to be taken into account. Finally, we intend in applying a varying displacement, shearing displacement program for the evaluation of the fault friction. We are going to input the frictional response at the obtained frictional response at the mesoscale in a macroscale model in the interfaces of the sliding earth blocks. And finally, the new bounds of friction that we have obtained are available for applications in earthquake control. I would like at this point to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this presentation, which was quite clear. And just would like to say to our foreign colleague that it is